Hello, we are Team One, and today we're going to present to you Youn Habitat and its response to COVID-19. This is the table of contents, and we're going to first go over what Youn Habitat is and its mission and goal. Then we're going to discuss the current Youn Habitat-led project called Greener City Partnership. And then we're going to talk about how Youn Habitat responded to COVID, its actions and the results. And finally, we're going to go over SDG Generation's possible contributions to achieving Goal 11. First of all, we're going to talk about what Youn Habitat is and its mission and goal. This is the logo for Youn Habitat, and the slogan is "For a Better Urban Future." The full name for Youn Habitat is United Nations Human Settlements Program. It is a program for human settlements and sustainable urban development. It was established in 1978, and it was an outcome of the first United Nations Conference on Human Settlements and Sustainable Urban Development held in Vancouver, Canada in 1976. To find out more about Youn Habitat, you may go to the link younhabitat.org. There's a new focus for Youn Habitat this year. The focus is to promote transformative change in cities and human settlements through knowledge, policy advice, technical assistance, and collaborative action to leave no one and no place behind. The specifics are the following four sections. First is to reduce spatial inequality and poverty in communities across the urban-rural continuum. Next is to enhance shared prosperity for cities and regions. And third is to strengthen climate action and improve urban environments. The final section is to create an effective urban crisis prevention and response. There are multiple ways to get involved with Youn Habitat. Through advocacy, communication, and outreach, Youn Habitat mobilizes public, political, and financial support and collaborative action to inspire qualitative change in national development plans, policy frameworks, development practice, and investment choices for sustainable urban development at the local, national, and global level. The following five logos are some programs coordinated by Youn Habitat. To begin with, the World Urban Forum, or WUF, is a premier global conference on sustainable organization and sustainable urbanization. Next is World Cities Day, which aims to promote the international community's interest in global urbanization, push forward cooperation among countries in meeting opportunities and addressing challenges of urbanization, and contributing to sustainable urban development around the world. The observance day ties in with Sustainable Development Goal 11 to make cities inclusive, safe, resilient, and sustainable. The general theme of World Cities Day is Better City, Better Life, while each year a different sub-theme and a location for its global observance is selected to either promote successes of urbanization or address specific challenges resulting from urbanization. Another part is World Habit Day. The purpose of it is to reflect on the state of our towns and cities and on the basic right of all to adequate shelter. It is also intended to remind the world that we all have the power and the responsibility to shape the future of our cities and towns. Another campaign held by Youn Habitat is Climate Action for Cities campaign, which is where people supercharge ideas to solutions and take action in cities and communities to win the race of climate action. The final program that I will introduce is the World Urban Campaign, which acts as a global advocacy and partnership platform to promote dialogue, sharing, and learning about improving our urban future. It is driven by a wide range of dedicated partners, including civil society organizations, local authorities, the private sector, research institutions, professionals, academia, parliamentarians, trade unions, youth groups, and the media. The campaign works to place the urban agenda at the highest level in development policies. It also helps partners to share best practices and innovative ideas, working together towards a better urban future. The campaign also works with national governments to encourage national urban campaigns through which governments can develop, debate, and articulate their goals and national strategies on sustainable urban development.
Next, our team would like to talk about the current Youn Habitat-led project, Greener Cities Partnership. Before moving on, the main goal of Youn Habitat is SDG Goal 11, And Greener Cities Partnership is also one of the many projects that UN Habitat is working on to achieve this goal. There are 10 targets of Goal 11, and rather than reading out all of the targets, I would like to explain it as a whole. Goal 11, the SDG 11 represents a shift in international development cooperation from a focus on poverty as a real phenomenon to recognizing that cities, especially in the global south, are facing major challenges with extreme poverty, environmental degradation, and risk due to climate change and natural disasters. While solving these issues, SDG Goal 11 also tries to promote to create more sustainable and an inclusive, resilient city too. Moving on to the explaining this project, UNEP and the UN Habitat launched it together to advocate and promote environmental sustainability in urban development and to mainstream environmental considerations into urban policymaking. There are two objectives of number one, to mainstream environmental considerations into local, national, and global urban policymaking. For number two, to highlight the local and global linkage of environmental issues. The main priorities are resource flows, efficiency and resilience, waste and wastewater management, transport and mobility, and monitoring and reporting the urban environmental SDG indicators. One of the ongoing works are Chengdu projects in Aeron Kwasfin City. Chengdu does not have natural barriers, such as mountains or rivers, confining the city in a particular shape. As a result, the city faces urban sprawl, causing a centralized urban heat island, poor ventilation, ecological fragility, traffic congestion, and other urban environmental problems. To solve these problems, UNEP and UN Habitats are trying to set up an ecological green line with the help of the Greener Cities Partnership to protect the environment, curb urban sprawl, and optimize the spatial infrastructure of this ring. And for the Aeron Kwasfin City, UNEP and the UN Habitat are helping to monitor specific urban SDG indicators, which will help the Aeron government to create future sustainable city-related policies.
Here are some examples of green cities initiatives, urban agriculture and urban-rural linkages. Urban agriculture has multiple positive effects. It allows a certain level of self-sustainability within the city, which can lead to shortening supply chains and providing fresher food for the people who live in the urban area. Urban agriculture can also naturally increase urban green space. Green spaces in urban areas improve air quality and urban heating, which is why they are one of the most expected aspects of sustainable cities. Green spaces can also heal urban citizens who must be exhausted from dull buildings. Linkage between urban and rural regions allows better access for urban population to crops and resources in rural areas. The linkage may also shorten supply chains, which can later lead to lessening the emission of greenhouse gas. Increased interaction between the two areas accelerates the development of rural areas as well as their infrastructure.
Another category of Greener Cities initiative is water provision. Water provision projects are increasingly in need because of contaminated water due to pollution and scarce water supply due to global warming. UN Habitat and UNEP focus on developing integrated waste management strategies that include both solid waste and wastewater management. UN Habitat also conducts independent projects, such as supporting innovation in water and sanitation in Egypt, and local support in Jordan and Lebanon. The riverbank filtration technology is an environmentally friendly process which relies on natural soil filtration to treat the water, producing clean water. And it is cost efficient in comparison to conventional large-scale water treatment stations and can be built very rapidly. The arid region is one of the most vulnerable regions of the world to the negative effects of climate change and is now considered the planet's most water-scarce region. At the same time, the region is home to the world's largest population of refugees and displaced people, with Lebanon and Jordan ranked as the largest and second largest refugee hosting countries in comparison to national population. UN Habitat is conducting a four-year program starting from 2021 to support local communities with water supplies. Next, sustainable transportation and mobility. The African continent has the poorest public transportation system in the world. The UN Habitat and UNEP are mostly focusing on the African region to 1. Promote rapid bus transport and non-motorized transport facilities in Africa, 2. To contribute to the transport component of Kenya's climate strategy, and 3. Establish a forum for promoting sustainable transport in Africa and support the development of action plan for sustainable transport in Africa. The sustainable transport systems can help us reduce traffic congestion, reduce accidents, use land effectively, and consume cleaner energy. UN Habitat is performing various independent projects to tackle the problem of public transportation as well. And it is a private-public partnership between the UN Habitat and Kantar. The project includes conducting a major research study to forecast how the population's preference for certain modes of transport in 31 cities around the world will be, and which scenarios will be more likely from a consumer and expert perspective. The research also includes providing predictions on which means of transport and technologies will increase or decrease, and to what extent they will have a major effect on existing business models in the transport sector and on how people commute in cities.
Thank you, Jisun. And following that, our team will explain how the UN Habitat responded to COVID-19 in 2020, as well as its actions and overall results. So as the pandemic is having a major impact on the global economy and the effects are felt at the local level, in 2020, the UN Habitat launched its COVID-19 response plan to support communities and cities as they face challenges together. The response plan outlines the urgent actions the UN Habitat will be taking cities and communities in 64 countries. They aim to help cities and local governments to protect their populations and start the recovery process. Now, the UN Habitat COVID-19 response plan focuses on immediate action in poor and densely populated areas. And over 70% of support targets work with informal settlements to improve affordable access to water and sanitation, raise awareness about COVID-19 prevention and care, and support initiatives to prevent people becoming homeless. Now, research found out that over 90% of COVID-19 instances are found in cities throughout the world. Cities are bearing the brunt of the crisis, with many suffering from overburdened health systems, insufficient water and sanitation facilities, poor housing conditions, and other more issues. This is especially true in poorer areas where the pandemic has highlighted deep-seated disparities, such as the 1 billion people living in slums and informal settlements. Now, this is one of the fact sheets that UN Habitat released in 2020, highlighting the impact of COVID-19 in poor and highly populated urban areas as one of the most urgent problems. Firstly, over 1,430 cities in 210 countries were affected by COVID-19, and over 95% were found in urban areas. And 1 billion people live in informal settlements and slums in overcrowded and inadequate housing. And 2.4 billion people lack adequate access to safe water and sanitation. And lastly, $72 billion were needed by UN Habitat to help meet urgent needs in cities and communities in 64 countries. Now, in response, UN Habitat concluded that urgent action is needed to help them stay safe and healthy. Now, I'll hand it on to Eun-tae, who will talk about what UN Habitat focused on.
Thank you, Jungeun. In reference to COVID-19, UN Habitat provided two different types of answers. UN Habitat's global, national, and city-level COVID-19 responses focus on urban areas that need help. Stopping the spread of COVID-19 and reducing its effect in urban areas requires access to adequate water and sanitation services. People living in slums and informal settlements require special care, especially during the pandemic, because it's almost impossible for them to follow instructions such as lockdown and social distancing, requiring agencies' urgent actions to be taken. To solve these problems, UN Habitat support concentrated on three things: as well as urban data and monitoring. Firstly, by delivering water, it is possible to increase the availability of fundamental urban services and provide them with healthier lifestyles. Secondly, sanitation and hygiene facilities. Unfortunately, these basic and most important things were not available in these overcrowded areas, and so sanitation service providers must be supported. Lastly, the agency used smart technologies to track and monitor the emergent spots to shape and localize responses. Mapping and analyzing vulnerabilities can also help them reorganize buildings and facilities for emergency health services. For example, UN Habitat installed a network of 415 hand washing stations, distributed 157,210 surgical masks to residents, and supported 60 schools with critical cleaning supplies in informal settlements in Yangon after the first outbreak in Myanmar. As a result, 157,000 individuals directly benefited from this. Policy and program frameworks, which is the second type of response, focus on supporting the government and community. It can be briefly broken down into three categories. Regarding health, they collaborated with WHO and other partners based on their experience of the Ebola virus in 2014. Moving on to the humanitarian part, UN Habitat has been working closely with humanitarian partners to help include internally displaced people socially and economically. They also use the fast tracking system to gather information about how countries are dealing with the crisis in terms of preparedness and recovery. Last but not least, they also assist the governments and cities with slum upgrading, basic services, raising awareness, and the list goes on. Additionally, they repurpose their development portfolio in 64 countries, identifying their gaps through the UN country team. They did this to plan for a more resilient urban future together with the UN framework.
Here are the programmatic results that UN Habitat did during the COVID era from 2020 March to August. They achieved a lot of things to alleviate the damages from COVID-19. Here are some pictures from the UN Habitat. The first picture is water provision in Ghana, providing water to the slums. Water sanitation is the crucial thing for the COVID not to spread. Second and third pictures are showing UN Habitat educating about COVID information in China and also training the use hand sanitizers and the techniques to protect from COVID. In September, a total of $25 million was raised to support UN Habitat's COVID-19 response, totaling 35% of the $72 million allocated to fulfill the urgent needs of 64 countries. UN Habitat has helped 6.8 million people in 37 countries and more than 250 cities as part of the overall response. As a result of the COVID-19, UN Habitat has prioritized its efforts in slums and informal settlements. So far, residents of slums and informal settlements have reaped the greatest benefits. UN Habitat will focus on these parts on post-COVID-19 eras. First, health and development. Reviewing and setting standards, manuals, tools in relation to urban determinants, including poverty, inequality, and morphology and impact on the SDGs. Second, governance and urban finance. Reviewing lessons learned, capacity building tools that can inform innovative and resilient recovery strategies. Also, central role of urban planning. Understanding the central role of urban planning and infrastructure in the post-COVID-19 recovery and the opportunity to start rethinking the way to plan cities. They'll focus on emergencies as well. Understanding long-term implications of pandemics and public health emergencies for the ongoing work on UN Habitat. Socioeconomy. They will link with urban finance and spatial inequalities. Lastly, are the basic health services. They will invest in basic services, housing, and slum upgrading. They will keep work hard to achieve the SDG goals.
To make our presentation more interesting, Team 1 came up with a sustainable city plan for Seoul. So how can we make the city of Seoul more sustainable? Why did we choose Seoul specifically? Now, according to the World City Population 2021 report, Seoul is the 33rd largest city in the world. And according to the United Nations News, experts estimate that by 2030, there will be 43 megacities in the world with each more than 10 million inhabitants. These megacities face various challenges, including housing, transportation, energy systems, infrastructure, employment, education, and healthcare. And Seoul is not free from these challenges either. So as a UN Habitat team, we figured out several solutions for the Korean government to make Seoul a better place to live. The first issue is urban poverty. Urban poverty refers to a set of economic difficulties in industrialized cities due to low income or low wealth. It usually occurs because of housing crises or unemployment issues. And the overcrowded area in which the urban poor live is called a slum. And Seoul also has several communities where underprivileged people live together, mostly known as Daejeonhae. Grabbing the public attention to the isolated area through art projects can produce jobs. There are many successive examples of recovery projects, even in South Korea. Sojedong in Daejeon City is where railroad workers during the Japanese colonial period used to live together in the past. The houses were abandoned for a very long time until Daejeon City recreated the old houses into mini art galleries, restaurants, and cafes. So if you look at the picture, they preserved the outer structure of the traditional houses, but renovated the interior of the house. So the buildings on the left are a cafe and a restaurant, and the murals on the walls also add on to the artistic atmosphere of the town. Sojedong successfully attracted a lot of young tourists, and these efforts to recover slums and isolated communities should be continued by the local government.
Mass production of carbon dioxide in South Korea is mostly due to the country's industrial structure, which is mostly oriented to manufacturing. South Korea produced 12.22 tons per capita in 2018, in which Seoul's production contributes the most. South Korea has produced 28 million tons of methane in 2018, which takes up 3.8% of world total population. Production. The government's aim is to cut down emission amount to 19.7 million tons by 2030. This mass production of methane gives credit to excessive personal vehicles. South Korea signed the Global Methane Pledge on November 2, 2021. The problem of greenhouse gas emission can be solved through increasing the installation of solar panels in households. In Europe, citizens' energy cooperatives have installed small-sized solar panels on rooftops and balconies to self-produce energy for their household. The self-consumption system can reduce excessive generation of electricity. Renewable communities in England, Ireland, and Wales successfully reduced 65,000 tons of carbon emission and produced approximately 6 million community benefits. The local government of South Korea is already financially supporting households to encourage the application of solar panels. However, the majority of the public don't even know the existence of solar panel assistance programs. The local community needs to try harder to advertise this project for more active participation.
Reducing methane gas could happen through the construction of bicycle roads. According to the Persian News, only 2% of the Seoul population rides bicycles for transportation, while in Copenhagen, 40% of the population rides bicycles. The Seoul Environment Association conducted a survey, and a lot of citizens replied that there aren't enough roads for bicycle riders. Not only that, some of the bicycle roads are damaged and dangerous. We should benchmark the system of European nations to prepare a greener transportation system.
This slide is about how us, the youth, as SDG generations, could contribute to achieving Goal 11. First, we should try to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in our daily routine. We could take public transportation or walk to places that are close. When ordering food, we should consider transportation distance and try to order things from the closest place as possible. Alarming people is also very important. You must know something well to start an action about it. As a youth, we can set up a student database with information about SDGs or Goal 11. Joining or founding school clubs are one possible way to create an archive. Lastly, bringing down UN youth campaigns to local level. By doing this, we can encourage local policies about the goal and also attract youth participation for such campaigns. We should always keep in mind our responsibility as the SDG generation and try our best to recover planet Earth as much as we can. As a final say, we hope of a world where there is a better urban future. Thank you for listening to our presentation.